Turning now to the maritime conflict between the Philippines and China, tensions again rising after the passage of key Philippine maritime laws. Beijing warns it will have no choice but to retaliate against what it calls Manila's infringement and provocation in the West Philippine Sea. The statement follows Defense Secretary Gilberto Teodoro's accusation China is pressuring Manila to abandon its sovereign rights in the region.
What we see is an increasing demand by Beijing for us to concede our sovereign rights in the area because of our need to explore and exploit the resources in these areas for the benefit of our own people. And that is clear. We don't need to enter into a geopolitical nexus for determining the root cause of the problem because we are direct victims of Chinese aggression. In this and in a concentrated area so far, thus far, in the West Philippine Sea.
Despite the landmark measures, dozens of Chinese Navy and Coast Guard ships continue to loiter in the West Philippine Sea. Last month, nearly 30 Chinese vessels were seen passing through the country's exclusive economic zone. The Philippines defense chief believes the incoming Trump administration will not expect Manila to pay for Washington's military support and protection against China's maritime aggression. He expects Philippine security partnership with the U.S. to remain unchanged under a Trump administration. He notes both Manila and Washington face a shared threat posed by China.
To answer your question, I really don't expect some sort of a statement from Mr. Trump. Hopefully not. I really don't have any preconditions or any assumptions as to what will be the outcome of his administration, except on what we are working on institutional ties this time, on the fact that we have an interest, both the United States and the Philippines, in ensuring that our partnership continue because, not totally, but principally because of shared threats. And that is undoubtedly the overreach and the aggressive and illegal activities of China. And if that changes, then maybe the calculus changes.
Good for the U.S. That's how PLDT's chairman and CEO Manuel Pangilinan described Donald Trump's return to the White House. Pangilinan believes Trump will focus on strengthening the U.S. economy. He thinks the Philippines must implement measures to protect the peso as Trump threatens to slap hefty tariffs on Chinese goods.
So the impact on the Philippines, on PLDT particularly, it's not too much because we most of our debts are in pesos, no? So we do have some debts, foreign debts, but only about 5%. In terms of the Philippine economy, there's got to be some interest rate cuts to stimulate the economy and as an antidote to what the U.S. might be doing. But we do have to rev up our exports.
The House Quad Committee decides to push through with its drug war inquiry today. The panel initially planned to move the hearing to November 21st in order to verify the credibility of witnesses.
Because of the several witnesses who wanted to give their testimony before the Quadcom, we decided that we should maybe interview them all first. Tingnan namin, sino ba yung mas credible doon? And it will take a lot of time, no, para sa amin.
Thank you for that question, Tina. Lagi namin
sinasabi kapag may mga witness. But as it turns out, former President Rodrigo Duterte agreed to finally attend the probe into his bloody drug war. He also threatened to confront lawmakers for their decision to reschedule the hearing. But Quadcom leaders asserted they notified Duterte and his lawyer about the initial change in schedule. They said they did not receive any formal communication from Duterte's camp.
There are several comments from the vloggers of I don't know which camp is that, no, saying na wala pong naduduwag dito. Gayto ho, para ho malinaw. Sa 21 meron kaming hearing. Yano, punta ho tayo dito. Pagkatapos ng 21, let us know kung kailan kayo pwede. Because we will schedule another Quadcom hearing on the date convenient for you, on the date na gusto ninyo, para ho mailatag natin ng maayos ang ating imbitasyon.
I-formalize natin lahat kasi nga pag yung sa social media tayo nagsagutan, I think it will not be proper, no? At maliligaw po tayo. Especially yan, nagpo-pronounce sila that they will be attending. It's not even coming from the president. We are governed by the rules of the committee.
Propaganda lang, no? Yung ginagawa nila, lalong-lalo na yung pag sinasabi nilang pag-attend sa committee hearing ng Quadcom, no? Nabubudol-budol nga, no, yung ating mga mamamayan.
Retired Police Colonel Ruina Garma detained in the U.S. over a canceled visa. Authorities say Garma left for Washington, D.C. with her daughter between November 7 and 10, but was blocked entry upon their arrival in California. There is no hold departure order that could have prevented Garma from leaving the country.
I think that it's a human rights issue that was considered by the U.S. government in canceling her visa. I don't know. I don't know who asked for it, but certainly when she was on the way to Japan, she was in Japan going to the U.S., she was informed that her visa was canceled already.
She had a visa, but apparently in the course of the hearings ng Senate, her visa was canceled. So, nagbaka sakali yata siya na pumunta ron, dumating siya sa Amerika. Ang US Immigration INS, ang USINS ang nag-flag sa kanya. Detained sila and they are in the process of being sent home here, back here to the Philippines.
The Philippine government, meanwhile, is considering to make Garma a state witness. The former PCSO official has previously implicated former President Rodrigo Duterte in drug war killings.
There are many things about it, because the cases against her or involving her have not yet been filed. We're still conducting case buildup. In any case, she's considered a very important witness by the Quadcom. That's why we intend to offer her witness protection for that matter.
An update on the weather now. Ophel has intensified into a typhoon with signal number 1 raised over Cagayan and parts of Isabela, Mountain Province, and Ifugao. Let's get an update on the weather now from Pagasa forecaster Chanel Dominguez. Good morning, Chanel.
Good morning, Bettina. Good morning to all. So let's get an update with our two tropical cyclones that we are currently monitoring. So first, let's get with Ophel, who strengthened into a typhoon category. It was last spotted at 595 kilometers east of Daet Camarines Norte with maximum sustained winds of 120 kilometers per hour and a gustiness up to 150 kilometers per hour. It is moving westward at a speed of 25 kilometers per hour. Due to this, we have a tropical cyclone wind signal number 1 over Cagayan, including Babuyan Islands, northern and central portion of Isabela, Apayao, eastern portion of Kalinga, and eastern most portion of Mountain Province. We are expecting to offer to landfall over eastern coast of Cagayan or Isabela tomorrow afternoon, and it will emerge over the Luzon Strait by Friday and turn more northwestward while slowing down before heading erratically during the weekend. So another tropical cyclone that we are currently monitoring is tropical storm with international mani, which we will be called Pepito once it enters our Philippine area of responsibility. It was last spotted at 2,210 kilometers east of eastern Visayas with maximum sustained winds of 75 kilometers per hour and a gustiness up to 90 kilometers per hour. It is moving west-southwestward at a speed of 30 kilometers per hour. It is still outside our Philippine area of responsibility, so it doesn't have any direct effect with our country, but in our forecast track we are forecasting a landfall scenario over northern or central Luzon by the weekend. That's Leticia Pag-asa Weather Forecasting Center, Chanel Dominguez, and good morning.
Thank you very much for the update, Chanel. More than 36,000 families in 5 regions have been affected by Typhoon Nika. This translates to about 153,000 individuals living in more than 300 villages in Ilocos Region, Cagayan Valley, Central Luzon, Bicol, and the Cordillera Administrative Region. Overall, nearly 15,000 people remain in evacuation centers. The Office of Civil Defense, meanwhile, says most of the residents in Cagayan Valley will remain in evacuation centers as the region braces for OFEL.
Mga areas na talagang susceptible pa rin ay hindi po pinapayagan ng ating local government units kasi lubhang mapanganib po yun. At saka kung natapos na po o dumana na po yung bagyo ay hindi pa rin pinapabalik sila kasi yun nga yung pagbaba ng tubig ulan mula sa kabundukan po ay maaaring magdulot ng pagbaha. Pinapayuhan namin yung ating local government units na siguruduhin muna po yung kaligtasan ng ating kababayan. Bibali na po pagtagal sila sa evacuation centers, basta ligtas lamang po sila.
The State Weather Bureau warns storms may continue to batter the country until the first quarter of next year. Pagasa says this is due to the prevailing La Niña-like conditions forming clouds in the western section of the Pacific Ocean. La Niña is characterized by warmer sea surface temperatures, prompting evaporation and convection that can form into weather disturbances.
Usually, mga zero or slim chance yung pag-develop ng bagyo pagdating ng January, February, March. Pero ngayon, nakikita natin may possibility at least isa kada buwan until March 2025.